Good morning. Before we start, I'd like to share scripture, Psalm chapter 20, 6 through 8. Now I know that the Lord saves his anointed. He answers him from his holy heaven with the saving power of his right hand. Some trust in chariots and some in horses, but we trust in the name of the Lord our God. They are brought to their knees and fall, but we rise up and stand firm. As we rise up and stand firm in him, let us share this song today, which refers to some trust in chariots, but we trust in the name of the Lord our God. Please stand. Celebrating Veterans Day this week, Pastor has a special video he would like to share with us right now, and then we will have our first hymn. Thank you. Thank you. If you are able, please stand and join us in our opening hymn, Hymn of Promise.
Worship. Forgiving God, you have given us from the abundance of your love for us. You have provided a good and perfect gift in the life of your Son, Jesus. We so easily turn away from you and your love. Heal our hearts and our wounded spirits. Allow us strength and wisdom to be looking forward to Jesus' return. May we have our eyes fixed on you more than the world. In the name of Jesus, the risen Son, through the power of the Holy Spirit, amen. You may be seated. I'm trying to find my other marker here. But we often read Psalms as we begin to set the tone, give us some wisdom. This morning, we're going to start by reading Psalm 78, and I'm going to read verses 1 through 8. We'll say, and that's okay. We'll pick it up. On my people, O my people, listen to my instructions. Open your ears to what I'm saying, for I will speak to you in a parable. I will teach you hidden lessons from our past, stories we have heard and known, stories our ancestors handed down to us. We will not hide these truths from our children. We will tell the next generation about the glorious deeds of the Lord and about his power and his mighty wonders. For he issued his laws to Jacob. He gave his instructions to Israel. He commanded our ancestors to teach them to their children, so the next generation might know them, even the children not yet born, and they in turn will teach their own children. So each generation should set its hope anew on God, not forgetting his glorious miracles and obeying his commands. My extra verse 8, then they will not be like their ancestors, stubborn, rebellious, and unfaithful, refusing to give their hearts to God. Amen. I'm going to use that marker though for later. So some of you have a bulletin in your hand, and if you do, that's where we would put our prayer requests. So if you have something you would like to write down, you can do that. If you want to write it down, say you don't want it to be spoken or read out loud as we are live broadcasting this morning, you can just write it down. You put it in that plate, we'll get that this week, and as a group, we'll pray over that for you. If you do have something that you would like to say out loud, you're welcome to do that as well. So Janet, I think it was Sias, right? She's over the COVID part of the problem. Now she's got to go back to the surgeon to find out what they're going to do about her breast cancer. Make sure that we are praying for Riverside Schools, for the families of Mackenzie Nogler. I wrote them down, first names next to each other. Mackenzie Nogler, Brooklyn Jackson, and TJ. I think that was right. Just pray for them. I don't know if everybody maybe does or does not know, but Mackenzie lost her life in a car accident yesterday. Brooklyn is quite beat up. I don't know about TJ, but obviously, regardless of what physical injuries he has, this is not going to be something easy. It's not going to be easy for classmates and for friends and for family. So keep all of them, including your teachers and your school staff, because they're gonna really go through this too. Family of Dorothy Roby. Dorothy got word that she had passed Friday afternoon. So, okay, keep David Roby in your prayers. He may or may not have. Continue to keep praying for Bill, his caretakers, and his healing. Pray for healing for John Bensman as well. How about that? How about that? In the midst of one is the other, right? Marilyn is hopefully going to be home for Christmas. She's off hospice, looking to start PT and ready to come home. Good news. Good news. Mike Clark is doing okay. He's getting out of the step down and called Abby this morning and is wanting to get out of there soon, hopefully. Of course, you know him, but. Yeah, don't forget to pray for the driver of the other car. Not mentioned here because obviously we don't know who that is, but they're not impactful. They're impactful to someone's life, obviously. And they're going to have to deal with that as well and struggle through that on their own. Anybody else? Okay. Not till March, yeah. I didn't think so, so we'll have to probably move that one away. Bill Eisman's birthday is in March, not November. We'll fix that. I think it is. I'll look it up. Yeah, Ruth Rowley is going to turn 90 this Friday, so that's a big one. Yeah, also this coming week. Susie Smithers. Yeah, Wanda's going to be 101. That's coming up. Lots of birthdays, lots of things to be grateful for. Absolutely. Continue to pray for your country. Don't stop. Don't stop now. Keep praying. And I'm trying to figure out, okay? I don't know about you. I don't know what you prayed or how you prayed this past week. But I know how I prayed. And at some point, I'm going to have to be trusting that he's in control the way he's telling me he is. So, might just have to keep doing what we're doing. Anybody else this morning? Let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning. Great and merciful God, we oftentimes have trouble locating you. We have trouble seeing you. We have trouble hearing you. And we wonder if you're really ever there. God, this morning we pray that you would send your Holy Spirit to us and that we would hear you, we would see you, and we would wake up. There's so many of us that are going through turmoil, we're going through things in our lives, and sometimes your presence seems fleeting. Unfortunately, God, many times it's not due to your leaving, it is due to our leaving. God, give us the courage this morning to face the day and the days ahead unafraid. That we would fill our hearts with hope, hope in you and in your Son, Jesus. It is this Son of yours who died on our behalf, was our lamb that was slain for our sin, who rose on the third day. He ascended into heaven and he is seated at your right hand at this very moment. Even now he hears us and he intercedes on our behalf. You've been listening to us all morning. You've been listening to us all the time. You've heard the names that we've lifted. Janet, the family of Dorothy Roby, Marilyn, who is such a praise, Josh, Bill, these people that need your healing, these people that need your care, the praise of birthdays that are coming up, so many. And God, we pray for those who have lost their life suddenly. God, may we be reminded that this life is fleeting. There is nothing permanent about where we are. And yet do not allow us the cynicism of trying to make our relationships less important because of it. Let us instead dig deeper. Let us love greater. Let us forgive easier. And let us be there for one another in ways the world cannot. That our heart would reflect and look more like yours. And that the world around us would be changed because of who you are, not because of who we are. God, there are things in our lives that we cannot answer for. Things that we can't explain. And there's many things that we didn't say because we're feeling them or we're experiencing them inside. We didn't want to raise our hand or say them out loud. And so, God, we take this time as your Holy Spirit is here with us in silence and we address you directly and we speak to you and we cry out to you. Lord, hear our prayers. Hear our confession and provide in us forgiveness. Allow us to see that we have not been everything that we could be, and that you are empowering us to be more. God, give us grace that we might provide that same grace to others. And give us a hope that can never be taken away. No matter what this world brings, you are still God, and you still love us. And your Son is still coming back. God, we pray this morning that you would just light a spark in us, a piece of us that would never be moved, a rock that would be a firm foundation, and that you, God, would be forever praised. That regardless of our circumstance and regardless of where we are, you are still God and you are forever. This Son of yours taught us how to love and care for one another, that we should reach out and put others first, that we should have a servant's heart. And God, we pray that you would give us that heart, that you would give us a place in your kingdom, that as you return, we would see you, we would know you, we would be assured and have hope in this eternal life. This Jesus is the one who makes it all possible. And he's the one that taught us how we should be praying to you. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, and thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. You are looking in your bulletin there. It says that this is the noisy coin offering time. We don't carry the coin baskets around anymore, at least not right now, thanks to COVID-19. So there is a little bucket placed outside the door, so on your way out, you're going to have to walk right by it, so drop some change in there. We are going to continue to support our younger people in their ministries and things that we're going to be doing, so hopefully we can do some things that are going to be outside the box, hopefully soon. So, for those of you that are interested in standing for the reading of Scripture, you may do that now, as we are going to dig into our Scripture reference today. Matthew, in the book of Matthew, we are going to be in chapter 25, and I'm going to read to you verses 1 through 13. Then the kingdom of heaven will be like 10 bridesmaids who took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish, and 5 of them were wise. The 5 who were foolish didn't take enough oil, olive oil, for their lamps, but the other 5 were wise enough to take along extra oil. When the bridegroom was delayed, they all became drowsy and fell asleep. At midnight, they were roused by the shout, "Look, the bridegroom is coming. Come out and meet him." All the bridesmaids got up and prepared their lamps. Then the 5 foolish ones asked the others, "Please give us some of your oil because our lamps are going out." But the others replied, "We don't have enough for all of us. Go to a shop and buy some for yourselves." But while they were gone to buy oil, the bridegroom came. And then those who were ready went in with him to the marriage feast, and the door was locked. Later, when the other 5 bridesmaids returned, they stood outside calling, "Lord, Lord, open the door for us." But he called back, "Believe me, I don't know you. So you too must keep watch, for you do not know the day or the hour of my return." This is God's word for God's people. And you may be seated. I know what you're thinking already, right? What does that have to do with being thankful, right? But we'll get there. I don't want to dig too deep into this, but for most of you, I know how your week was. It wasn't great, and it wasn't awesome, but we're still here. We're still hopeful, and we're still proud of who we are and who God's made us to be. And I pray that no matter what, the more that we face adversity and opposition, that we are remaining in that steadfastness of being rooted, of forcing ourselves, sometimes jumping to the chance to grow and being spreading of the gospel. It's in that we find our strength and our hope. I appreciate those of you that risked coming back. I know this is now a dangerous work environment, so I have to admit, when I saw the blinking lights on the altar, I was a little nervous. But I'm glad you came back. I'm also glad that we have great, wonderful people who have now provided a fire blanket for us up here. I feel so much safer. So I appreciate that. But no, for a lot of you, this week did not turn out the way you wanted. You're worried about the future. Your anxiousness and anxiety is through the roof, and you're worried about things like truth and honesty. For some of you, it went exactly the way you wanted it to go. And you're happy and you're excited, and whatever it is, and whichever side of this that you're on, I have to tell you that Jesus is still seated at God's right hand. God is still on the throne. God is still sovereign over all things. He does not need us to complete a plan that he can already have in place. The end is going to come. He's already ordained this. In today's parable, as you're going, what does this have to do with Thanksgiving? It's the story of the bridesmaids. I don't even understand where you're going with this, Pastor. I can read your minds. I can see it on your faces. Like, that was weird, right? And it was for me too when I first thought about this idea. However, this plays perfectly into our theme of November, which is being thankful for. And today we're thankful for Jesus' return. Now, if we are the believers that we say that we are, and we believe that the Bible is true, then we believe that God is telling us the truth when John, in the book of Revelations, which we talked about last week, lays out the plan for how the end of this world happens and the beginning of the new heaven and the new earth start. Talked about that last week, right? In this parable, told by Jesus, mind you, he's talking about his return. He's talking about the fact that there are people waiting for his second coming. The whole story is about his second coming, right? The bridesmaids, that's us, the church, the believers of Christ. We are waiting on this return. Now, how many of us are waiting on his return and we're getting bored and we don't think this is taking forever? Thousands of years so far, by the way, in case you're counting. And we fall asleep. I'm tired. While there are other bridesmaids in this group, right, that are prepared. They even went and got extra oil. They are stocking up. They are doing the right things. They are continually pumping into the lamp. Keeps it lit, right? Some of us are fully prepared, some of us are not. Some of us think we're fully prepared, but are we really fully prepared? Obviously, we know that the bridegroom that they're waiting on is Jesus. And just like those bridesmaids, we have no idea of the exact moment when he is going to return. We are waiting and we're hoping on this wondrous occasion. And we are wanting that moment where we get to run into the wedding feast and that new heaven and that new earth are finally experienced by us. We have a group of bridesmaids that are all hanging out and we're all trying to figure out what it is and when it's coming. One of the problems I see with this text is that they are in this together, right? There's 10 of them. And they're in this together. Now, there's 5 of them that are prepared and 5 of them that aren't. And so what is that we wait too long before we decide that we're going to help each other and share with each other? In other words, we get to the end and we hear the message that that Jesus is coming, and that's when we get worried. And we all try to light our lamps, but by that time, we don't. The ones who are prepared, well, they don't have time. They don't have the resources now to help you and to bring you with them, so you got to go get that yourself. And there's a disconnect in between what is happening to them because of their unpreparedness and what they're going to get to experience. We see the unprepared bridesmaids go out and try to find more oil for their lamps, but in their attempt to hurry up, they miss out on the return. It's too late. The door is closed. The wedding feast is happening, and Jesus says, I don't know who you are. We know that Jesus is returning someday. He's coming back for his people, either in this life that I may hopefully someday get to see in this body, or in the life after this one. When we begin thinking about being prepared for this event, we often think of in terms of works. Right? How many times have I volunteered at the food pantry? How many times have I donated something? How many times have I done something within the church? How many Bible studies am I in? Because we as tangible beings, we want markers, right? We want things that we can check off a list. That's the way we work. We're tangible. Unfortunately, in this preparedness, it's a place where things aren't quite tangible. Where were they going to go get the olive oil? Where were they getting the oil to fill their lamp? Do you physically have a lamp that you're trying to keep lit until Jesus returns? I don't physically have a lamp. I do, however, have a spiritual lamp. Oh, right back to the light that we talked about for weeks, right? Those that are prepared, they have the spiritual oil in their lamp that is keeping it lit and keeping it prepared. Sometimes when we get tired, we fall asleep, right? In the midst of something, and then we miss it. There's so much going on in our spiritual lives that oftentimes we miss out because we're just bored. Admit it, it's okay. I'm doing that same daily devotional over and over.
It will now.
So we're constantly waiting and trying to find a way for this oil to fill our lamp, but we don't have any idea what it means to have this oil. What does it mean? What are we filling ourselves with on a daily basis that is filling up our lamp? Oftentimes we're not filling it with things that Jesus or God would tell us are the oil that he's looking for. We fill it with food, work, relationships, politics. We fill it with things that aren't going to prepare us for the coming of Jesus.
Being prepared is more than acts of goodness. It's more than works. It's more than things that you could check off a list. Being prepared is preparing our hearts for our individual walk with Christ. One way in which we can be prepared and make those preparations easier is an attitude of constant thanksgiving. Paul illustrates this many, many, many times. Always be thankful, no matter the circumstance, he tells us. Always. Why? Because our gratitude grows things in us that the world really doesn't want to be there. The world would rather have us worried. The world would rather have us anxious. Our natural instinct, our natural fight or flight mentality, our survival instincts will always take us to the negative. Why? Because that's when those survival instincts kick in. Hope, gratitude, thankfulness, that stuff is not a matter of survival. But if we want our lamps to be full, it needs to be. Gratitude and thankfulness are similar words together. And when we express those, whether we write them down, whether we say them in our head, whether we share them with someone else or not, they can change our lives. They can change the way we feel. Scientific studies have shown that people who keep a gratitude journal, not only are fewer of them depressed and anxious, but fewer of them have physical ailments. There was a study done, and I can't remember the college hospital, the university hospital that did it. They took heart patients, and in over 48% of the patients that they had, those who chose gratitude daily and chose to keep a gratitude journal experienced a decrease in their heart symptoms by almost 50%. They were physically getting better, and the only difference between them and the other patients was their gratitude. There's more and more and more of those studies out there. So why don't we do that more? Well, because the world is overwhelming. Think about it. Think about what happens to you on a daily basis. The world is constantly barraging you with the problems of the world, right? The end is near. Is it? I don't know. Maybe it is. Your life on a daily basis, it's got problems. You were trying to get to work on time. You got a flat tire. Right? Fixed the flat tire, got to work, everything's okay. Oh, I got a sick kid at school. I got to leave work. I got to go pick him up. Right? I don't have enough money to pay that bill this month, so I'm not going to pay it. The world around us is there to basically be a detractor from your gratitude, your thankfulness. And it's stealing away the joy and the hope and the peace that you should be experiencing if, in fact, you're looking forward to eternity. I know for me, I'm looking forward to that eternity. I'm looking forward to somewhere that we talked about last week where there is no more pain, there are no more tears, there's no more crying, there's no more sorrow. There's none of that there where we are going. And yet for some reason, we make this world so attractive. Probably the only thing that this world gives us that is of any consolation to this at all is relationships. Because that's who God is. That's why we're built that way. We don't want to leave this earth because of those relationships. It's the people, it's the hearts, it's the souls that we experience, sometimes deeper than others, that we don't want to let go of. And that makes it hard here on this earth. We have experienced in the last 24 hours in this community great loss. And the reason that it hurts is because of the relationship. And friends, I have to tell you that I have hope. I have hope that Jesus is telling me the truth, that when he says he's building a place for us, he is. And that if I have that hope and I have that belief, I can hurt and I can mourn, but I can also be experiencing joy and a full lamp because I know what's coming. This is not the end. There is so much more. I quoted in this week's Quick Shot, if you saw it online, a quote from Melody Beatty. And she says that gratitude unlocks the fullness of life. It turns what we have into enough and more. It turns denial into acceptance, chaos to order, confusion to clarity. It can turn a meal into a feast or a house into a home, a stranger into a friend. There is power in that. There is strength in that. James chapter 1, verse 17. He says that whatever is good and perfect is a gift coming down to us from God our Father, who created all the lights in the heavens. He never changes or casts a shifting shadow. We always talk about why bad things happen to good people, right? Bad things happen to all people. But it doesn't happen from God. He's not the one casting the shadow. That happened a long time ago when Adam and Eve fell and broke that relationship. That's the way this world is. That's why this world is eventually going to come to an end. It's going to basically tear itself apart. And there's a new one coming. And that brings us hope. That brings us thanksgiving and joy. I was thinking about it as I was on my way to church, first church in Maplewood this morning, and I couldn't help but get overwhelmed. And I thought to myself, why am I here? What's the purpose? Does anybody listen? Does anybody care? I don't have any idea. And it's not up to me to be the determining factor of that, because if it is, I'll never find it. I'll never know it. It'll never be enough. And I thought about why I am where I am today, not just position, but spiritually. And the only reason that I am where I am today is because I let God in. I realized that I was never going to be enough on my own, that I was never going to live up to the pressure or the circumstances, or I was never going to be enough on my own. And so as I encountered God in a new way in our small group that my wife and I started, we were basically pushing ourselves outside of comfort zones on a weekly basis. And I was like, God, I'm so grateful. I am so thankful that you shoved me and I went for it and I got involved in that, because that changed my heart. It changed who I was. It changed where I was going. It changed the trajectory of everything. And I'm so thankful for that. And then I got to church. And other than my wife and maybe one other person, everybody in that small group happened to be there. Carrie Beth was there playing music. It was just incredible. And I was like, now you're just showing off. And it happens to us when we understand that our preparedness isn't about the activity itself. If it was up to me, that would be a lot easier, right? We could just push the broom so many times and the floor's clean. We could just flip the light switch on enough times and it'll stay on forever, right? If there was a key to this, if there was a checkbox on a list, it would be a lot easier. But it's not a checkbox, because it's a matter of heart. It's a matter of what's happening inside of us. Our gratitude and our thanksgiving are part of that preparation. when we understand that there is nothing this world can do to take away the coming of Christ, we begin our journey of being thankful and being prepared for that return. I'm going to tell you this today, and I know you already know this, but there is nothing that this world can do that can take away your eternity. You know this. So why does the world play a part in it? There is nothing that can take this away from you. There is no president. There is no political party. There is no force of nature. There is no accident. There is no religious organization. There is absolutely nothing that you can put your faith and your hope in this world that will either take the place of eternity or provide it for you. Jesus Christ is the only one that has done that, and he is doing it day after day after day after day. And you can be a part of it or you can walk away from it. It's totally up to us. We have that choice every day. If we want to be prepared, we have to understand that Jesus died for your sins, not for anything else. And he did so that you would not have to keep looking and waiting and wondering about whether or not he was going to return. He is. And you are assured of this. It is time to be prepared. It is time to put our hearts in the right places. And if our feet and our hands and our mouths react because our hearts are in the right place, then that's great. That's what they're supposed to do. But we shouldn't put the cart before the horse. I love that song this morning, being thankful, not for the chariots, but for the one who provided it, basically. We begin our preparations daily when we are giving thanksgiving to God. And I'm going to challenge you for the rest of the month, start writing down every day when you wake up, before you turn the news on, before you grab your phone, write down, either write it down physically, write it down mentally, say it verbally out loud. I want you to be thankful for five things every day. Every day. I woke up this morning. There's one. The sunrise was awesome this morning. That's number two. My day's not even started yet, right? We're still morning. I got to see people smile. That's three, right? It's easy. But man, it changes our hearts and it changes the way we think and it changes what we think about. God is wanting you to be waiting patiently on his return. And be prepared by filling your lamp with the right kind of oil. Amen. Join me as we say a prayer for our offering this morning. Father in heaven, offering is a time where we respond to you. You've been speaking to us this morning. Your word has been open to us, and we heard you. Now we respond. You've given us out of abundance. You've given us money, time, energy, talents, gifts, all these different things, one more so than the other, because that's your body and that's who we are. And God, we take whatever it is that we can give you, and we lay it at your feet. God, we pray that whatever we can provide you through your church, that the world around us would see your face. They would know your compassion and love, and they would hear you calling out to them. That whatever we give to you, you multiply it. You make it great so that we cannot boast in anything but you. God, take this offering and give us that kind of joy. We pray this in the name of your Son, Jesus, who makes it all possible with the strength of your Holy Spirit. Amen. If you are able, you can stand and join us in our closing hymn, How Great Thou Art. And so there's a line in a song that says, I know that he's real because he parted the seas for me. I have to tell you that he can do that today. And I'm going to leave you with Colossians chapter 3, verses 14 and 15. And he says, above all, clothe yourselves with love, which binds us all together in perfect harmony. And let the peace that comes from Christ rule in your hearts. For as members of one body, you are called to live in peace and always be thankful. Friends, have a great week.